I want to thank you for turning out tonight. It's really rather remarkable to see so many people in one room. This is Donald Trump's biggest nightmare. So I wanted to try something different with you. I actually did prepare a formal set of remarks. They're here. If you feel like you haven't gotten your $5 worth at the end of the event, then you can email me and I'll send you these 22 pages. You know, they're double spaced, 14 size font. And then if you don't like the prepared set of remarks, then we'll give you back your $5. But I'm gonna leave the script aside, because I'm in a little bit of a, I'm in a fighting mood, if you will. And we did promise you that this would be an evening with me about the fight of our lives, and so I thought we would just let it rip, and I would tell you what's on my mind, what's been on my mind. I guess you can guess a bunch of it, although we'll give you more details. And then I wanted to make sure we had ample time at the end to turn up the house lights and then to take questions. We have microphones, and I really want this to be interactive. I've been watching the MSNBC every night, right? And I really get excited when I watch those town halls, when the folks are just so frothy and angry and engaged, and I'm hoping we don't have a lot of that dynamic here, but I do want us to engage with each other. And the one thing I will tell you is that, you know, we've been talking about this being the fight of our lives, and I've been in my job now for more than 16 years. I started the week before 9/11. And I remember thinking in the immediate aftermath after 9/11 that, well, nothing can get worse than this, is what I thought. And then, who knew it could get worse than this? But I wanted to start a bit somberly and to talk about that the events of 9/11 were incredibly challenging. The country was still coming off of a very acrimonious moment. We had a president who many said wasn't elected, but rather appointed by the U.S. Supreme Court in the Bush v. Gore decision. There was lots of debate about where our democracy needed to go. And then with the attacks on that tragic morning on 9/11, everyone got quiet. The Democrats were afraid to ask the tough questions. People were fearful. People were rightly fearful. I live in New York City. I'm born and raised in New York City. And I would have a view out of my one bedroom window of the World Trade Center that then went away after that morning. And so as New Yorkers, we were stunned and shocked and fearful. But more troubling than the tragic loss of life and 3,000 people who were murdered that morning was the way in which our democracy went quiet. And I was stunned in the initial days. I was brand new to the organization. I hadn't even unpacked my boxes. Hadn't even gotten my business cards yet at the ACLU when we were really full guns on issues like the Patriot Act. The Patriot Act was enacted 30 days after the events of 9/11. And I remember making the rounds on the Hill and talking as the new guy on the block to some of the members of the Senate and the House that I knew before, and I knew the ACLU even longer than they had known me. And it was really difficult to get them to engage these issues. I remember having a conversation with Paul Wellstone, who was a senator, a great liberal senator out of Minnesota. And I remember sitting with him in Washington, D.C. in a very quiet, kind of private dining room after he had voted for the Patriot Act. I said, "Senator, what were you thinking? Why did we give this administration such a blank check on law enforcement powers?" And he said to me, "Well, Anthony, this is a really hard time. We have to stand with the president. We can't ask the tough questions. I'm in a tight race. Let me get through my race, and then I'll make sure I'll have you on the Hill in some of the hearings, and we'll repeal parts of the Patriot Act." He died tragically 3 weeks later, you might remember, in an airplane crash. And as tragically for our democracy, we never got around to repealing segments of the Patriot Act. It would only come afterwards, and many years later with the Obama administration. And we saw then the piling on around issues around the Patriot Act, around the creation of Guantanamo, around the use of torture and waterboarding, about the use of rendition. And there were moments when that crisis after 9/11 just felt like it was really going to bring our democracy to the brink of when some of the most basic and most important values that America had always subscribed to were really up for grabs. And then slowly, the opposition began to mount. You know, we continued to file our lawsuits. Congress began to ask different questions. The events that unfolded would shock the conscience, the photographs of Abu Ghraib, the stories around Guantanamo, the stories around the black sites in Europe where we had tortured individuals. And slowly people came around to asking very important questions that were not asked in the beginning. And I remember thinking at the end of the Bush years, I said, okay, well, it took us 8 years to create this resistance to these policies. And a lot was lost. I mean, there were some things that were tragically forsaken. When America decides as a matter of policy at the highest levels of our government to break the law and to torture individuals, that is something that you don't come back from, right? You have crossed the Rubicon. And I remember thinking, well, we did the best we could in a time and we tried to mitigate the damage and slowly we'll build back from it. And during the Obama years, not everything was perfect. That was a president that I very much believed in personally. I never believed in any one candidate as much as I did with the promise of President Obama. He did many things that I laud him to this day. There were many things he broke our hearts on. He continued the military commissions at Guantanamo. He continued the use of drones that started under George Bush and that really took off when he was president. And I remember the first time I met President Obama in a meeting that he called off the record, right off of the Oval Office. I was told it was there just to kind of share experiences, and I was really summoned there to be dressed down, where he told me that my comparisons between him and George Bush were simply not helpful. Right? And I began to sweat. I've only met a couple of presidents in my life, and I've never been dressed down by one before. It reminded me of the Catholic nuns that I had. And I somehow found the courage of my voice and said, "Sir, with all due respect, when your policies are not substantially different, the comparisons that we draw are fair and accurate, and they will continue from our court." And I remember thinking, wow, this is kind of a heady moment when you think about the President of the United States being concerned about the criticism of our organization. I felt that was really when we earn our stripes. That's yeah. When we are an organization that we don't shy away from confronting even allies when we think they're wrong. And so we were in the process of after the end of the Obama, or toward the end of the Obama term, we were preparing for the presidential election. We had begun to make plans for what the different scenarios would play out. The Hillary Clinton scenario, we knew her pretty well, both as senator from New York and as Secretary of State, obviously as First Lady. Her policies were pretty well articulated. There were places we knew that she would need to be pushed harder. We worked very hard to develop a report that would push her further along the line on things like immigration, where we thought that she needed to be bolstered in a concern for immigrants. But we were largely looking forward to, and this is the moments of regret, we were looking forward to the what I call the golden age of Supreme Court and federal court litigation, right? I was salivating over the idea that even if Merrick Garland was not himself confirmed in the Supreme Court, that fifth justice would go to someone who had to be more liberal and progressive than Antonin Scalia, may he rest in peace, right? And so we began to think about, okay, now what are the cases and the lawsuits we would bring? with a majority liberal court. Cases that we had often thought about but never dared bring because we knew they'd be hard to succeed with. Cases like looking at the Hyde Amendment around the prohibition around abortion services with federal dollars, or thinking about solitary confinement as cruel and unusual punishment, or outlawing the death penalty. Again, and you know, thinking through of what would be the legal strategy to build off of our Supreme Court win on same-sex marriage with the Obergefell case and bring full equality to LGBT people in housing, employment, and public accommodations. And boy, we had a plan, right? And as is my nature, even as I was focusing a lot of energy on what that plan would look like, I said, we need to prepare the plan for what if Donald Trump wins. And my staff at the ACLU, you can imagine, the people who come to us, they are highly independent, very articulate, question authority, especially the boss. And they're like, why do we have to prepare the Trump scenario, right? We've got too much work to do. He's not going to get elected. We just let us focus on what we need to really focus on. I said, no. This is part of my type A personality. I didn't think he would win, but I wanted to be prepared if he were to win. And I forced our colleagues to develop a full plan on all of his various positions. And that was a lot harder than you would have thought. First off, figuring out what the man stood for was almost impossible. There were, unlike Senator Clinton or Secretary of State Clinton, where there were policy proposals, there was a platform, and there were a campaign, and there were people who would tell us what she thought, we were kind of grasping at straws, like what does he stand for and what does he say? So we literally had to hire an outside opposition research firm who tracked him on the stump. Literally, this is the only way we could figure out what he was actually saying in different places. And sometimes it was rather curious. Depending on where he was, he would contradict himself in the same day, right? He'd be in a blue state and he would say, I love Planned Parenthood and they are important and they provide reproductive health services that women need. And Ivanka would be in the picture, and then 4 hours later, he'd be in a red state, and he'd be like, we have to defund Planned Parenthood, and we're like, all right. But then we collected all of his statements, and to the best of our ability, then kind of figured out what the editorial line was, and then we got to work, and we began to analyze how would we challenge those promises if he turned them into policies. And then we issued a report in July, still on our website. It's still good reading because he's been true to his word. We took him both literally and seriously, and we did this analysis in July that looked at his statements on Muslims, on reproductive rights, on the First Amendment, on civil rights, and then we outlined what those policies were. We issued a report in July. We tried to push it out to all the news outlets. I got bumped off of Rachel Maddow 3 times that week because no one thought he was getting elected. So when I'd say, I want to go on TV to talk about the Donald Trump memo and the analysis we did, we'll get back to you. And yes, today, oh, not today, tomorrow. And then it was, and then the third day I got canceled. And okay, I read the report. I thought it was really quite good. and then when the election came around and many of us were still stunned, we had a plan, and that came from months of preparation where we had done the legal analysis. And then between election and inauguration, we really doubled down. Then we began to really take that first analysis and really begin to design the lawsuits, identify the clients, think about the theories, thinking about the strategies for how do you split the circuits. And so when he was able, when he finally took the oath of office on January 20th, we had done a lot of the homework before the election, and then a lot more of the homework before inauguration. And so there are 6 areas I want to cover for you before I open it up to all of you. All right, so I want to first start with the issue around immigration. And there's probably no more important issue that will affect as many people in this country as his wrong-headed, un-American, unconstitutional promises on the detention and deportation of undocumented immigrants in this country. Just to give you a sense about how it's evolved, he first talked about deporting all undocumented immigrants, 13 million of them, right? And in the July report, you will see, we did a whole analysis of what that would require if you tried to deport 13 million people in the span of 4 years as president. It's just simply that there is no way that it could possibly use the legal machinery to push through and deport and push out as many people as the president had then promised. He backtracked a little bit right before he took the oath, and he said, I'm going to focus on the 3 million undocumented immigrants who have criminal records. Well, let's break that down, right? So certainly we're moving from 13 to 3. 3 is still a lot, right? President Obama was named and labeled by some of the Hispanic groups as the deporter-in-chief. And that's because in his tenure as 8 years of president, he had deported the largest number of undocumented immigrants of any modern president. The reason why he did that, I believe, from both conversations with folks around him in the White House, is that he doubled down on immigration enforcement as a way to push through comprehensive immigration reform. Remember the pathway to citizenship. He wanted to find a way to provide immigrants a way to come out of the shadows and to have a pathway from undocumented status to citizenship. And he thought the only way he would convince the Republicans to get with him on that plan would be to show himself to be tough on immigration enforcement. So that's where, in the early part of his tenure, he began to put his foot on the pedal on enforcement and say, let me do what's necessary. He struck a Faustian bargain with the devil, ultimately got jilted at the altar by the devil, if you forgive the mixed metaphors. And then at the end of his tenure, when he realized that the deportation machinery was really wreaking havoc in the community, tried to ease up on it, but it was a bit too little too late. But still, even in that kind of very aggressive moment, he deported 2.5 million people over the span of 8 years. Now, President Trump promises to deport 3.5 million people in his first year, right? So that's 1.5 times the number that Obama deported over 8 years. And so the human carnage of having all of those individuals uprooted from their homes. And what's most challenging about this is the fact that there is no master list of illegal aliens. The undocumented immigrants live among us. You might have a mother who's undocumented with 3 U.S. citizen children. You might have the undocumented grandmother who's the caregiver to all the U.S. citizen kids in the family. You might have a U.S. citizen father with an undocumented mother. There's no way to yank the undocumented immigrants from our communities without really ripping apart the fabric of families, of communities, of neighborhoods, ripping apart American citizens from immigrants. And to what end? Other than just an ideological promise to a base that is xenophobic and hostile to the important contributions that immigrants have made in our country, really kind of forfeiting the kind of the values that we are a nation of immigrants. And so when Donald Trump promised to deport 3.5 million people, we should take him at his word. Today's New York Times, if you haven't read the article, they talked about how the deportation efforts in the first couple of months of the Trump administration have gone up by more than 40% of deportations over the Obama numbers, which were already too high. So he's making good on that promise. And for us at the ACLU, that is our number one priority. We've begun to hire people and lawyers in places like Texas, New Mexico, Colorado, California, on the southern parts of the United States where you have a lot of migrant families and migrant workers. And unlike some of the other litigation where it's more constitutional analysis that you can do in submission to the federal courts. This type of litigation is very fact intensive. You have to go to the detention centers. You've got to interview the immigrants. You've got to document the unreasonable searches and seizures and the violations of due process. It's a lot like the work we've done to fight Sheriff Joe Arpaio, or former Sheriff Joe Arpaio. For 10 years, we have put our boot on his neck. Ultimately, he was thrown out of office, about to be thrown into jail for contempt of court. But it has been litigation that we've been doing for 10 years, right? And you've had to document the unreasonable actions of the Maricopa County Sheriff and Police Department on stopping American citizens and permanent residents and individuals, and they're just using skin color and ethnicity as proxies for suspicion. And that's what we have to be able to scale up on as we fight the detention and deportation of the undocumented immigrants. Second issue is issues around reproductive rights. Now, if you haven't read the news, and I appreciate the fact that you're here tonight and you are supporters and members of the ACLU, if there is one other organization you must join, it is the Planned Parenthood of America. Absolutely. And with all the mumbling that the president said on the stump, and Ivanka, her stock must be down because he's become much more frothy and anti-Planned Parenthood, so she must not be getting access to the Oval Office, daddy must not be listening to her. The fact is that his promise to defund Planned Parenthood, which is codified in this House bill to repeal and replace the Affordable Care Act, would defund Planned Parenthood would mean that they would lose $500 million of federal reimbursements on Medicaid assistance to poor men and women for whom Planned Parenthood is the only source of reproductive health services. And we're not talking abortion services, right? There's no question that you can't use federal dollars for abortion services. But federal dollars through Medicaid reimbursement will be used, has been used, properly used, on pap smears, STD screenings, IUDs, birth control pills, mammograms, the essential services that people need to live full, healthy, productive lives that only the Planned Parenthood is able to provide. And to yank $500 million from that institution because with private money they also provide abortion services, we think is unconstitutional and unlawful. And let's be clear, the reason why that is because you cannot penalize an institution or an individual for the proper exercise of a constitutionally guaranteed right. It's like saying, I'm gonna yank your Social Security because you voted Democrat. Well, you have a constitutional right to vote. And you have a constitutional right to terminate a pregnancy when and if you want. And so how dare they threaten with a sword of Damocles, say, we're gonna get funding for the Planned Parenthood on non-abortion services because they're engaged in a constitutionally protected right. It's utterly illogical, un-American, unlawful, insane, right? But in addition to that battle that we're seeing at the federal level, the battle for reproductive rights is that they've unleashed the anti-choice agents at the state level. And so you have all of these folks who believe that now is their time, they've been waiting for this moment when the Republican Party would control both houses of Congress and have someone in the Oval Office who would defund Planned Parenthood. And let's push through those aggressive bills. Let's close down that one clinic in Kentucky. Let's force the women in Florida to wait 48 hours before seeing a doctor and getting the termination. Let's push a 20-week ban. Let's push an 8-week ban. That is what we're fighting against right now. We have had to bring 6 different reproductive rights cases at the state level even as we're fending off the battle at the federal level in the defunding of Planned Parenthood. And I'm sorry, there is no more fundamental right than the right to decide what we do with our own bodies. It is not for politicians to decide. Our organization believes that we decide. We are in charge of my body, my speech, my mind, who I love, what God I worship, if any God at all. We believe in the sanctity of human individual volition, and that our job is to get out of the way of the individual to actualize and to fully live a life that they decide is the right one for themselves. And there's no more fundamental challenge to individual rights and freedoms and liberty than the rights around reproductive health and rights. That's bucket number two. Bucket number three on the First Amendment. Now here, you would have thought that this was rather well established. Even some of the conservative members of the court at the federal level, at the Supreme Court, have been First Amendment supporters. The First Amendment is hollow ground for conservatives. We don't get them to agree with us on civil rights statutes or Title IX or protections against ethnic minorities, but the First Amendment, you can normally get them to agree. So here you have a president who even does a double barrel on the First Amendment. It was remarkable. In the run-up to the election, he talked about wanting to change the nation's libel laws. That's right. And so we kind of scratched our heads. I'm like, well, do we even waste the space on this? There is no federal libel law to change. Right? It's rather well established. What are you talking about? Right? But we decided to just stick it in. Right? Stick it in. But then also the whole debate around the ban on Muslims is fundamentally a First Amendment issue. Yes, it's an immigration issue. Yes, it's a racial justice issue. It's also a First Amendment issue. And so when we talked about in the early days that a Muslim ban would be contrary to established jurisprudence on the First Amendment, that the First Amendment talks about the freedom of speech, freedom of assembly, the non-establishment, the freedom of the press, and the free exercise and non-establishment of religions. Right? It's a reason why they put that in the First Amendment. Right? The right to speak your mind, the right to associate with whom you want, the right for the press to inform us, and the right for us to decide what God we worship, if any God at all. And not that government can ever sponsor a religion. And the idea that in explicitly saying that we want to ban all Muslims from the entry of this country was absolutely antithetical to the Founding Fathers' original view that part of what America was built on was the belief that we will not impede someone's right to worship whatever religion they want, nor will we establish a religion that is government sanctioned. And one of the ways they protected against that was to make sure that there were not favored or disfavored religions, right? That was the essential part of it. In the colonies, there was a great concern in Virginia, in particular, in the original Virginia colony, there was a concern that if they banned certain types of religions from settling in Virginia, they would essentially be establishing a state religion, right? There was a whole big debate about whether or not the Quakers would be allowed into Virginia. Imagine, who could ever deny the Quakers anything? But the reason why they wanted to make sure that they didn't allow the discrimination against the Quakers was to make sure that there wasn't an establishment of an official state-sponsored religion. And yet here we have our president pushing the same issue, but this time on Muslims. And so when President Trump promised us a Muslim ban and talked about getting a Muslim ban and saying that he needed to kind of consult with the great leaders of Western democracy like Rudy Giuliani on how to do a Muslim ban. And then when he signed the executive order, you know, at the ACLU, we were kind of stunned because we had gotten, this is one of the things that's fantastic, and I hope someone in the press might write about this. We actually got a copy of the executive order the Wednesday before he signed. It was a beautiful photocopy on an iPhone that was taken like this. And so we had to enlarge it and enlarge it and enlarge it, and then we were reading it. And you know, lawyers, we have the kind of this gallows humor. We kind of, when we say something is great, it means it's really bad. It's a great case, you have a great client. Oh my God, it's terrible what happened. So we saw the executive, I'm like, it's great. Oh my God, it's so bad, it's great, right? Because in the executive order was this language that the president was going to protect minority religions in the 8 countries he was going to ban the entry of Muslims, predominantly Muslim countries. I'm like, the protection of minority religions, wow, that can't possibly be in the final order. When it came on Friday and we saw that it was still in there, we're like, this is great, we love it. And what was even better is that we started getting the press reports and our intelligent president was doing interviews on Christian broadcast radio the same day he was signing the executive order, saying how important it was to protect Christians. I'm like, yes. Please tweet about it. Please. Help me with the legal right. And so, 12 hours later, we were in court. Seriously. No way. We're not having this. We're filing in court. I was literally taking down my Christmas tree. It's January 28th, by the way. You can tell. The maid was the cleaning lady in my house. You know, she comes every 2 weeks. Said to me, "I'm gonna have to charge you more money if you want me to dust off the Christmas decoration." I'm like, I'll take it down. So I'm taking it down, and then I see all holy hell breaking loose. You know, people not being allowed into the country. You know, we knew that the executive order was bad. We'd been ready for it. We'd prepared for it. We didn't know they would try to implement it the same day, right? We had no idea they would turn people away, that they would hold them at airports. We started getting phone calls right away. We started dispatching ACLU lawyers to airports all across the country. Logan, SFO, LAX, O'Hare, Kennedy. We were holding up signs. ACLU lawyer here. We literally had lawyers going around and talking to the people outside the international arrivals terminals and saying, "Did your family member come out? Do you need a lawyer?" I remember getting these phone calls saying, "I found a man who's in the army, whose mother's coming in from Iran, and he's been waiting here for 5 hours. I'm like, "Great, have him go home, get his uniform on, and let's get him to a TV studio." And we had no idea it would play out in real time, and they had no idea either. I mean, so then that evening, Saturday evening, I go home after doing all the TV shows. Rachel Maddow then asked me to come on the TV show. I'm like, sure. Should have had me in July. You would have been better prepared for this event. Yeah. And then I get home, I'm taking off my suit, I'm ordering Chinese food, and my phone rings saying, "We have an emergency hearing in Brooklyn. Come." So I get dressed again. Go out to Brooklyn, it's 9 o'clock at night, Saturday night. And I'm showing up at the courthouse, and there are a couple, you know, there are about 40, 50 people from the courthouse. I'm like, "Oh, this is interesting." Yeah. I go in, I come out, 3,000 people from the courthouse, right? 3,000 people. And I'm just like, "Who are these people?" You know, we've never had that many people in front of a courthouse, even in Supreme Court cases, right? And they're chanting, "ACLU, we are here, we stand with you." I swear to God, you can find it online, it's amazing. And then we have one staff member, Molly Kaplan and Noah, who were there. You know, we had no press strategy, we had no press release, we barely could get ourselves there in time. And she's like, "We're gonna do a Facebook Live interview, so smile, Anthony." She holds up her iPhone. And I'm like, "Honey, that camera's really small." You know, it's like, "It's okay, just keep talking. That Facebook Live stream went to 18.5 million people. 350,000 people joined the ACLU that night. And then when they tried to say, okay, now we're going to take this back and we're going to do Muslim ban 2.0, right, where they take away Iraq, they didn't ban people from Iraq, they allowed the Syrian refugees in, they took out the kind of bad language around minority religions and said, now we're not banning against Muslims and we're not favoring the Christians, it's now it's constitutional. And they filed a second executive order. We were back in court. We have 16 Muslim ban cases at the moment. 16, right? The lead case for us is out of Maryland. The other lead case is out of the Ninth Circuit, out of Hawaii, where the state's attorney general is out of Hawaii and Washington State. One of those two, I think, is likely to end up before the Supreme Court. The reason why we filed 16 of them, one would have been probably good enough, two would have been good, three would have been nice. 16 of them because we want to throw as much at them as we possibly can. We're throwing sand into the machine, right? We want to drop it up. Now, let's make it as hard for them to move on to the next thing on your to-do list. So 16 is nice. 30 would be better, right, in my mind. And ultimately, what was great about the hearing last week and on May 8th last week, where our attorney Omar Jadwat, the head of our Immigrants Rights Project, he had some hostile questions from some of the conservative members of the Fourth Circuit. It's not like the Ninth Circuit, the Fourth Circuit is not as quite as friendly. But we did very well, and I think we're going to win. We have the votes. There was one judge in particular who said, well, because the Department of Justice is arguing that they can't take into account what the president had said before about banning all Muslims, or the statements from the administration. Oh, Jeff Sessions, this is one of my favorite statements. You know, Jeff Sessions, I haven't talked about him yet. I'm coming to him in a second. He actually said at one point, 2 years ago, quote, Islam is a toxic ideology, end quote. Now, we're not talking radical Islam. We're not talking fundamentalist Islamists. We're talking Islam is a toxic ideology. A religion practiced by billions of people over millennia, that our Attorney General, the man who's supposed to take the oath of office to uphold the laws for all of the nation's people, that an entire religion, one of the world's great religions, he obviously has never tried to read the Quran, right? Could be a toxic ideology. And so we've been putting all this into the record, saying, this is a Muslim ban, let's be real. And the judge, the Department of Justice, saying, no, it's not, you can't take into account these extemporaneous statements outside of the record. All you can do is read what's on the four corners of the executive order. And one of the judges said, excuse me, but reasonable people, including reasonable judges, will have reasonable memories. Fourth issue. Civil rights enforcement. Jeff Sessions, my buddy. Jeffrey Beauregard Sessions. Right? Boy, did they name that boy right. So, we had our legal director on this first day in the office testifying in the Sessions confirmation hearings. It's the first time we have testified in a Senate confirmation hearing in 97 years. Right? They call us to testify and say, well, we don't take positions on nominees for elected or appointed office. And with Jeffrey Sessions, we didn't take a position against him, but we figured, let's educate the public about what his record is, right? He talked about the fact that, you know, in addition to calling the ACLU and the NAACP communist, unpatriotic organizations, I kid you not, he called us that by name. He also had lots of questions around his voting rights enforcement. He one point said, I'm paraphrasing because I don't remember the exact quote, but I'm close, you can Google it. When they were asking questions around the discrimination against women and LGBT people, he said, I just don't see it. It's almost an exact quote. Well, how can you enforce the law if you can't see discrimination, right? So it's almost like, well then, you know, you should be disqualified from the job. If you just don't see it, then you shouldn't do this job. Go take another job, right? So, but this Attorney General really does have enormous ability to change the trajectory of our nation's civil rights laws. And the two places where we are most focused at the moment, one is on voting rights. You know, this lovely little commission that Vice President Pence and this fellow, Chris Kobach. Now, if you haven't heard of Chris Kobach, we've known him for years. We've sued this man every time we turn around, right? Out of Kansas. I mean, he's anti-immigrant, anti-voting, anti-abortion. I mean, it's just like, he was like a full employment program for the Kansas office of the ACLU. And now he just pops up as the chair of the voter integrity panel that he and Mr. Pence are leading up. And, you know, it's clear to us that this is going to be one of the places that we're going to have to spend a lot of energy to make sure that the right to vote and the right to cast a meaningful vote that is counted meaningfully is going to be the fight of our lives.
Yes.
Right? It's because they clearly are watching their poll numbers. They clearly are trying to figure out the electoral map both for 2018 and 2020. And the only way that they can probably see a way forward is by what we need to suppress some of the people who are voting. Right? What is the good news is that over the last several years, there seems to be a resurgence of the voting rights jurisprudence. This North Carolina case, so this North Carolina law that would have purged 300,000 mostly minority and African-American voters because of the photo ID requirements, that would have shrunk the window for registration and same-day voter participation, that would have denied young people the ability to pre-register to vote, right? So they're focusing on vote by mail and easy vote, usually for the elderly or for people who are retired. They're focusing on photo ID as a way to target minority voters. They're trying to target young voters. What do they all have in common, right? One of these things is a lot like the other, right? Remember that? They usually vote Democrat, the old, the young, the people of color, the minorities. And so we need to purge them, right? It's the way to win an election in North Carolina. And what was remarkable is that having won, that's not ACLU-friendly territory for us. Having won at the Court of Appeals, the Supreme Court decided to let it stand, struck down the law. And there's been similar cases by the NAACP Legal Defense Fund in Texas. We've had cases like this in Kansas. We have cases like this in Wisconsin. And we're beginning to look at the map where voting rights is really going to be essential to ensuring that the next election is full and fair and that people have a right to vote. And we're looking at places like Florida, so stay tuned, right? We were just talking with our colleagues out of Florida. There are many voting issues in Florida. Remember, that was the birth of the hanging chad. And I think there's a lot of good litigation advocacy we'll be able to do in places like Florida, Ohio, Pennsylvania, where the right to vote is really going to be meaningful, not just for the residents of that state, but for the future of our country. So the fifth issue is on LGBT rights. Now here, we would have thought that we would go from win to win. You know, we had filed the first same-sex marriage case in 1971, right? Two gay guys wandered into the Minnesota office and said, we want to get married. And I don't know the person who was taking the intake at the time. I'm sure they were lovely. They were wonderful ACLU types. This is before anyone had a kind of understanding of LGBT equality. Just probably looked at them and said, sure, why not? And what the hell? Let's give it a whirl. Filed a federal court, you know, litigation to get them married in Minnesota in 1971. We lost, but we stayed on it for 44 years. And here we want, we're finally with the Obergefell case, we would have thought that with having won marriage equality, that now is a time to push for full equality for LGBT people in housing, employment, public accommodations. And what most people forget, especially when we live in places like Seattle or New York or San Francisco, the marriage piece of the puzzle for many of us in these liberal cities was the last piece of the puzzle, right? Because we had local laws that protected us from discrimination in housing, employment, or public accommodations. And so it was the last piece to give us full equality in places like New York or Washington State. In other states, the marriage piece of the puzzle was the first piece of the puzzle, where you only have the right to marry your same-sex partner, and that you can get married on Sunday and fired from your job on Monday and evicted from your home on Tuesday, and you have no legal recourse. So we have been planning to use the Obergefell win as a way to really plow through the rest of the barriers to LGBT equality. And obviously with the election, that we are now playing more defense than offense. We are fighting off these transgender bathroom bills, which are critically important for the transgender community. Because ultimately, when you think about our client, Gavin Grimm, right? A young man who just said, I want to not be forced or humiliated when I go to the bathroom. I want to use the bathroom of my gender. And when his school requires him to choose a different bathroom, they're like forcing the stigma, the prejudice on that young man and just wanting to live with just basic dignity. And so it's critically important for the young people and the transgender members of our community to have that full equality right. But let's also be clear that the reason why they have picked this battle is not only because they are homophobic and anti-trans and hateful in their bigotry. They're also trying to derail the movement and the momentum on LGBT equality generally. Right? They're trying to throw the third rail, right? Derail us from what they know, where we're going. And they say, we need to stop them. And we need to use this kind of inflammatory and playing on fears and trying to divide good people of good conscience and goodwill to say, well, wait, let's not go this far. And that's why these battles are so critically important. And that's why it was so stunning when they decided to rescind the Department of Education, Department of Justice guidance on transgender, the rights of transgender students in public schools. And that's why we are doubling down. And there is movement afoot in your own state, which you all know much better, that we've got to make sure we fight that off, right? We cannot afford a loss in a place like Washington State or Seattle, right? Because what happens here, if that referendum gets qualified, you've got to kick its ass, people. You cannot let it even have a moment of viability, because what you do here will have great implications for whether or not we have any shot at having full equality for LGBT people in the rest of this country. So it is our Alamo in Washington State and Seattle. So I just hope you'll stick with us. Final issue is not focus on a particular set of individuals or communities. You know, I've talked about immigrants, I've talked about Muslims, I've talked about reproductive rights, I've talked about racial minorities and people of color. I talked about LGBT. The final bucket of issues for us is about the system of checks and balances. And when this president refused to disgorge his business interests when he took the oath of office, we knew the system of checks and balances was up for grabs, right? Because every other president, even Richard Nixon, God rest his soul, sold all of his business interests and bought a property that he later on slinked away to in shame when they impeached him. Right? But he sold all of his business interests and just had his one holdings in California. But this one decided, I don't need to do that. I'm just gonna let my boys run Trump Organization, I love it when I call it the Trump Organization. Really, you couldn't name it a better thing, right? It's like the Trump Organization. I'm from New York. Anything with organization in it, you kind of have to worry about. But they decided that we didn't need to kind of separate our business interests. We're going to hold on to the assets. We're going to let the boys run it. And I'm going to stay president. There's a problem. It's called the Constitution. It's called the Emoluments Clause, right? It's the Domestic and Foreign Emoluments Clause, right? They were there for a reason, right? They were there because they were worried that our founding fathers might be bought and sold by the kings of France or the kings of England or even the governors of some of these wealthy colonies. Remember, the federal government when we were first established was very small and weak. It was only later that it gained in power and influence. The state colonies were much more powerful. So they were actually worried about whether or not the president of the United States would actually be bought by the governor of Virginia. And that's why they created a foreign emoluments clause and a domestic emoluments clause. And that's been part of the Constitution. And we brought many constitutional lawsuits in our 97 years. We've never brought an emoluments clause lawsuit, never had to till today. And so we are in the process of finalizing what will be we're working out the details. We wanted to find a competitor to the Trump Organization, who either ran a hotel, or ran a golf course, or ran a kind of a wine industry. I have been trolling for clients. I can't tell you how hard it has been. I have sent out personally, from my personal email account, close to 75 emails to owners of various businesses saying, please let me represent you in this emoluments clause litigation. I flew out to LA, met with person who said no, ultimately. It's not that they're not, you know, they're good people, they're good-hearted people, they're just a little afraid of taking this on. I think I found one. We're in the process of wrapping it up. And we want to bring a lawsuit from someone who is basically able to say that because the president has not disgorged his assets, I, as a competitor, am at a disadvantage because he is being advantaged by foreign and domestic governments who wish to curry his favor by booking his hotels or his golf. Yeah. So that would have been the first indication that this president was not respectful of the system of checks and balances. On the first day he got elected, also this was fun, because sometimes you just have to find a little bit of joy because life is too short. We filed a FOIA lawsuit the day he took the oath, asking for any and all memos around violations of the Emoluments Clause. We figured someone in the Obama administration had to have typed up some memo saying, this is effed up, you know? And so we wanted to see if someone would, you know, we could get those memos under FOIA. That was the first thing we did. Now we're going in for the full on the merits litigation, and we'll see where we end up. Second place where you could see that he was disrespectful of the system of checks and balances is how he responded to some of the lawsuits and the judicial orders. So-called judges, right? When Jeff Sessions talked about the Hawaiian federal judge as a judge sitting in the middle of the Pacific, right? Like it happens to be the 50th state. Jeffrey Beauregard Sessions. And when you realize that they have such disrespect for the system of checks and balances that slowly was becoming unveiled to us, and then the events of these last week, oh my God, if I'm looking a little like I have gray bags under my eyes, it's because I don't sleep anymore. I watch the TV. I watch it in the morning, I watch it at night. I'm like, okay, I'm falling asleep. Let's turn on Fox News. I need to get my second wind. It is astonishing. You know, here you have Michael Flynn, apparently known to them that he was under an investigation and then still put him in as a national security advisor. Told by Sally Yates that he was compromised, that means that he was blackmailable by the Russians, maybe even in the back pocket of the Russians, yet didn't fire him, fired her, right? Whoops, right? Then they fired Preet Bharara, right? The kind of the US attorney out of New York, who was possibly also investigating some of the questions around the Trump administration, some of the folks on the cabinet, fired him after he told him that he was gonna be able to stay. And then fired Jim Comey, right? Which, you know, Jim Comey is no buddy of mine. Met him a couple of times, fault him for some things, respect him for others. Kind of astonishing that he fired Jim Comey. And then after firing Jim Comey, we found out that he asked Comey to go easy or not prosecute Flynn. Hello, hello. You know, the unlawful command of influence, obstruction of justice, alarm bells, right? And then, you know, you realize that there are investigations around Manafort and all these other folks. I'm like, okay, this system of checks and balances better hold up here, because this is a huge onslaught. And the only moment that I have actually felt relief has been when I heard the news yesterday at 6 p.m. that they appointed Robert Mueller. Now, I want to be clear. You know, we sued Robert Mueller at least on 24 occasions. He is someone who I actually got to know over time. He started his job the same day I started my job. And he went to Princeton, I went to Princeton. I'm a little younger than he is, although he looks pretty good for his age. He took a break in between the Bush years, and so I've been going at it, so I'm aging a little bit more quickly. But I believe that he came and spoke to our membership conference at the ACLU in 2004. You know, I didn't think they would have that. We invite them all. We always do, right? We invited George Bush. He never came. We invited Alberto Gonzalez. You know, he would run away from us before. But Robert Mueller took the invitation and came. And our members gave him a standing ovation. Some of you were there, remember. Not because they agreed with him, but because they appreciated that he had courage and he spoke to us candidly and directly about where we agreed and where we disagreed. Now, if anyone is able to get to the bottom of obstruction of justice in an effort to subvert the system of checks and balances, I do believe it will be Robert Mueller. Now, the problem is that we won't know enough, right? Because he doesn't work for us. He works for the Justice Department. And he will either come out with an indictment or a series of recommendations, but we're not going to see the fullness of the analysis. And we deserve to know more. Yes. Right? So that's why we have said, this is really good, but this is only a down payment. We need our congressional hearings. We need open investigations and reports from both the Senate and the House. The public has a right to know. Robert Mueller needs to pursue his criminal investigation and make his decisions. But we need to know a lot more about what's going on here, because I'm sorry, I've connected these dots, and I need to know a little bit more about whether how they're connected and whether they're connected the way I see them connected. And that's what we're pushing on now, to make sure that we don't just stop with the appointment of a special prosecutor. The final thing I will say is this. The one thing I will give Donald Trump credit for is the fact that we have 900 people in this room. We have 900 people in this room, and before the election, we had 400,000 members at the ACLU, right? And we had 280,000 members at the beginning of the Bush years. Over 8 years, it would go up to 550. After the end of the Bush presidency, came down to 400,000, stuck at 400,380 at the end of Obama. Donald Trump gets elected president, and our membership goes from 400,000 to 1.6 million part-time members. The average age of our membership is half of what it was prior to the election. That means there are a lot more young folks. That means that folks want to be engaged. We had a resistance training that we launched on our program where we had 225,000 people turn up as part of our People Power resistance training in 2,300 house parties in every state of the union. And they were trained on how to do the proper protest, when you need a permit, when you don't need a permit, what are the issues we're working on, that's how we focus on immigration enforcement issues. And 220,000 people took themselves physically to a stranger's home to be trained. And there have been more than 1,200 follow-on activities. There is something that is very different about this time. And if Donald Trump wants to take credit for anything, he can take credit for the fact that I think he has sparked the golden age of citizen activism and engagement. And I will close by telling you this. I promise you that we will stay on the case. I promise you that we will give it the fight of our lives. I promise you that we will be bold and aggressive and smart and tenacious and resilient. I will not promise you that we will win every time. We are up. We are the David to the government's Goliath. We have 350 litigators at the ACLU. We're the biggest litigation organization in America. 350 lawyers who bring cases. Jeff Sessions has 11,291 lawyers in the Justice Department. There are 19,000 lawyers working for the US federal government in the Department of Labor, Department of Homeland Security, the FBI, the DOJ, the CIA. 19,000 against our 350. So we are up against steep odds. But I know that failure isn't an option. You know, we have good arguments. We have you with us. We have fundamental values that these are worth fighting for. If not this, then what? And I promise you that even when we lose, and even when we stumble, and even when we get setbacks, that we're not going down quietly or without a fight. Democracy cannot be a spectator sport. In the face of what we're up against, these are not just rights, the right to freedom of speech, and freedom of the press, and freedom to petition one's government. These are not just rights, these are obligations. And so with you, together, if this isn't worth fighting for, then nothing is. So let's keep fighting for it.